Welcome back, guys, for our coverage of the face of a GSL Egaming Cup. And we have another NIP game. It looks like it's programming on Nuke as well. And Thorin's here doing the commentary with me today. And Thorin, will H2k have a better chance against NIP than the previous teams?
I think they will have a better chance. Will they win? No. The answer is no. NIP. And so those two factors mean no. Unfortunately, for anyone who's watched these games today, it might sound like we're overly critical of the teams who are facing NIP. You have to realize Nuke is one of the most tactical maps in the whole game. So if you're not as good as someone and they outclass you, you're going to look really bad in comparison to them in terms of how your tactical execution is and your understanding of where to attack and when to attack. So, I mean, if you're going to get mad, just get mad at the teams who actually keep choosing to like play on this map. Because if they're playing on Dust 2 or Inferno, it'd be a lot more loose. They could just get some kills. We could give them some credit. Oh, good play there. Seems like there's no one on the server now, mate.
Yeah, it does seem like they've disconnected from the from the server. Or it could be just GoTV. So just wait and they'll be back. And yeah, so it's, if anyone's getting sick of watching NIP, which I don't know, usually people just watch for NIP. I mean, it's always just wonderful.
I mean, you can only jerk off so many times in one day. Now, that like fifth one, you've really got to think about some evil shit at that point.
We have some evil stuff coming up next. It's going to be H2k versus Kick. So if anyone's into H2k and Kick, I mean, it's going to be a much more even game, at least, than the ones we've seen here today from NIP. And of course, you guys saw the schedule in Group B. Tomorrow we have Exasana, Dragons, clan-mystik, Hudsy's G team, and also GamePub, the Serbians, which is quite cool to see the Serbian team in there. I wonder how well they're going to do tomorrow. But it looks like they are jumping into the knife at the moment. To see who will
start. It's over the wires, so I imagine they'll do pretty well.
And
Serbians on the internet are like Neo in the Matrix. You know, in the real world, he's just like a guy who like is weak, his body's frail. He needs to build up some of that muscle atrophy that's happened. Well, in the Matrix, he's the shit, dude. He knows kung fu, everything.
I want to see these kung fu Serbians that you're talking about. I've never seen kung fu from the Serbians. I didn't know that they had kung fu over there. But we will find out. We just need some of that jumping kick business that you can do in Titanfall. You've been getting on the Titanfall hype?
No. I don't have 3 months to waste so that I can then never play a game again, just like every other first FPS that comes up.
And we have the fifth round going on right now. It looks like H2k on T side, they're starting things off slow. Got the smoke going out from Rubino there into the yard. Cover main, and we have slow movement in lobby. Fiffer and oh, gets caught with a nasty shot there. And they should have been able to see that, but it's just Skirk to hold the radio room to stop that flank from happening so they can push into upper seamlessly. And here they go, straight into upper. NIP going with a rotation. Very fast play coming in. It's still a 4-on-4 at the moment with Fifferin jumping up the ladder. Freiburg gets his head popped straight off by Maclord there at the vents. And things are looking good for H2k, but still the NIP players are breathing down their necks. Fifferin gets dropped though. Boris trying to make his way through CT main. Not going to happen. Just get right left. Spamming down, runs out of bullets, and that's H2k taking the pistol round on the T side of Nuke, which is very, very important. And I have to say, I mean, do like
ideal start for H2k, basically. They looked good when they got in. The NIP players were pretty slow to rotate. Actually, one of the things that we noticed when we were watching the Invitational was that by switching the roles in NIP, Keflaren was always playing the ramp room as CT. And actually, in that tournament, he struggled there. Like that, he was one of the players against Titan who had difficulty. So I'm going to be looking on this map on the gun rounds as to how he does in that ramp room. Because he couldn't hold it aggressively like they would have in the past. Because he's not as high-skilled a player, he had to drop back every time someone came in. So he was playing quite passively. So keep your eye out for that once we get to a full gun round for CTs.
Skirk, he is the man on radio room. He is feeling out ramp again. And let's see if he is able to find anything out to relay it to his team. H2k just holding strong for the anti-eco. Got to be careful not to drop any weapons or to have anything ridiculous happen here. Of course, you are playing, if you're in H2k's position, playing against NIP, so they're dangerous no matter what is in their hands. And NIP looks like they've read the situation well here. We can see Forrest and Fifterin waiting in a brilliant position there. Forrest does a lot of damage, doesn't doesn't get the frag though. And it does seem as if H2K are dealing very well with this setup from NIP, which was pretty strong actually. Only two players remain now. And it seems like the round should be quite simple for H2K. But GetRight grabs two quick headshots over at Ramp and picks himself up a P90. He's 1-on-3 though, and with a P90 long range, his odds are not favorable. The bomb is ticking away, and he will get shot in the face by the scout of Ply. So pretty decent anti-eco coming in there from H2K, even though NIP read the push very well from H2K, had a decent enough setup to try to defend from it. Were not able to execute though with the pistols. So another eco here coming in from NIP. Full eco, no special pistols bought, and Skirk is just going to run straight in. We go to a 4-on-4. So Freiberg gets cut down trying to push through the door there, but they do get information now at least on where the H2K players are, so they can concentrate their efforts a bit better. But the problem is there's only three of them. But Fifflerin and Forrest are going to try to work together now, pushing slowly around towards CT main, maybe trying to catch someone in the back if H2K decide to move into the upper site.
And now they're going to swarm and probably kill this guy, actually. Oh, what a great shot.
Ply coming huge there with two frags on the NIP players. Get right now moving through to CT main, gets caught in the back with the AK. And his life is not looking easy. Play another scout headshot. And 3-0 now. First buy round coming in from NIP. And this should be the telling round.
I thought
round.
The actual approach there to trying to get the guy outside, they did it right. They couldn't have known that he'd headshot them and spinning 180 headshot the other one. But overall, it was an okay approach. And they weren't going to win the round anyway. So now we have the first real gun round. Now we'll see where does H2K hit, how far do they go.
So here we have a standard setup coming in from NIP. We've got a boost up onto the silo from H2K with some smokes outside thrown by NIP to stop any fast pushes. Bomb dropped in lobby. They're going into pick mode here, just trying to spam each other down. H2K would benefit massively from a quick pick here, but I don't think NIP are going to be so foolish as to give them anything easily at the moment.
And now GetRight knows there's a guy right outside here.
Oh, what a beautiful play from Freiberger. They're dropping straight onto the angle through the door, getting that headshot. Now there's pressure on H2K, who lose another man and go 3-on-5 at this point in time. Rubino tries to get the trade on Freiberg, but he is just too strong. And now it's a 1-on-5, and Ply just has a scout. So it's all over for them here. Where do you feel like it actually failed there for them?
I mean, they just got picked apart one by one, so it wasn't really... we don't even know what the tactic was from H2K, though. We can't tell it. It looked like they didn't necessarily have something called. They were just going into a base strategy, then they were going to see, does someone get a kill outside? Do we spot someone? And instead, a bunch of different parts of the map, they just had one-on-ones that they lost, and then the round's over because, you know, there's nothing left to do. There's no tactic left to run with two people.
We've seen some... great move from Polly there, and he did hold onto that scout for a while, so he should have a lot of money there. Probably was saving for that AWP, but now we can see, of course, he's using that extra money he would have used for an AWP. Instead, Polly drops an AK for his friend and buys himself one, so that they can at least do a buy this time around. And H2K now, let's see how they're playing this one. Couple outside and moving back into lobby. Might just see a standard pick situation from them again. To be fair, as you said, we didn't really get to see their strategy last round, but they are actually pushing a couple players outside kind of fast at the moment around T Red, trying to get down secret, it looked like, or maybe to garage. But GetRight cuts down Rubino, which is really, really tough now for H2K, because it does look like they want to do kind of a 3-2 push onto the upper site. And look at that, Polly goes down. The headshot of GetRight. So now they have no one on the outside. This is really bad. So now their options are severely limited. And exist limits them even more with that headshot. Here comes Skirk. At least they get the kill onto exist, but now it's Freiberg ready for the defense. Too much damage has been done, and a cleanup comes in from Get Right and Freiburg to win the round. It did seem like they were going for a 3-2 split there on the upper side.
Yeah, but they took so long to do it. And at the moment, if the guy outside gets taken out, then they're done immediately. And so at that point, everyone knows there's nothing coming outside. We haven't seen anyone peek into the ramp room. And then people can afford to take risks, go in the hut, see if there's anyone there. If there isn't, then we know it's going to be ramp. Like, this is why I really hate slow play, unless you have something in mind for it. By default, you shouldn't play slow. Right. Unless you're a total mix and you don't have any strats, in which case it might be the only way you can play. But this is a real team. You're supposed to have set strategies that you're going to run. Now, either you can play slow and then decide later on what tactics to do, like Nip's been doing. But usually that only works if you're the better team. If you're just a normal team, then actually what you want to be doing is forcing certain strategies and then deciding how they worked after the fact, not like looking beforehand.
And actually, on the first buy round of NIP, we saw H2k, I think they were going for that same strategy, which they tried afterwards, the kind of 3-2 split on the upper site. But it's interesting because it seemed like they were trying to get the information of where the player was on CT main, if there was even one there. And in doing that, Freiburg just did his awesome drop to take one out, and then all of a sudden their strategy's blown up. And now they're in a 3-3 situation. It's still a full buy for them though. AKs all around. And is Mac just going to run through the smoke? Looks like Ruben is going to fall to Freiburg again. So Freiburg is just unchallengeable over that door. Squeaky there.
Now Forrest knows they're outside, so he's going to peek out, try and get some information. He spots one above, and he gets killed himself. This does give them an opening now, though. That's the opening they needed, because in theory, now you can pressure outside if you want.
Yeah, this does give a lot of options. Poly can just wrap around the outside of the map. So NIP are going to be feeling pressured. They have to watch more angles.
The problem is, Skirk really needs to show some presence inside and stop the guy pushing up radio room.
And Fifferin cuts down Maclord, which is going to make life tough for Skirk, who now really needs to return the frag. And Polly's now in the ladder room. They may... Oh, that's a very good timing there for Poly. Does grab the kill onto Fifferin. So that was really the saving play here, allowing Skirk to regroup with his teammate. Now they can make a combined effort on the lower side. Here go the smokes to try and cut off the angles from the vents so he can get a clean plant. But here goes Freiburg.
Freiburg's going to get a free kill onto the first guy.
And there it is. Might even get the planter as well. The bomb does go down at the very least. Tries to make his way to Toxic, but Freiburg's spray control is fantastic. And the defuse does come in. So 4-3 now for NIP, and the initial momentum that was gained by H2K is all but dissipating.
I mean, you've seen again and again, this is the beauty of watching the same map over and over and over with the same team. Every time when they're on CT, you give Nip that extra 5 seconds to communicate to each other what they're going to do and who's going to go in which order. And then after I do this, you do that. That's when every time they make the correct decision on paper. And even if they don't win the round every time, it means that they stack the odds in their favor so that they do win those 2v2 situations over and over. And it doesn't matter if you're getting in a good position from what it looks like from your side. You're then letting yourself get outmaneuvered by letting them have all the information.
Indeed. So it's again a slower kind of play. They are defaulting to this again, waiting for that pick, trying to move a man outside. Maclord, can he find a frag? Maybe get right up there, but no Forest from the window room. Too strong. At least Polly is able to get the trade, but here comes Freiburg beyond the smoke. And look at that. Hoyland from the TT main roof there, taking him down. And things calm a little bit as we move into a 3-on-3. And H2K are beginning to work the ramp. Here is Fifferin though. Key position, and he does find the kill onto Skirk. So now, oh, there you go. Polly gets caught in the side by Get Right, so now it's all on Rubino. So it's going to be extremely tough. Just going to try to get the plant down. The smoke wasn't even perfect, but he's got NIP players surrounding him quickly now. And very well executed from NIP. 5-3 now the score. And things just seem to be getting worse and worse for H2K. So pistol round now from H2K. Pistol rounds are extremely tough. I mean, they're a lot better than they were in Source of 1.6, but they're still very, very tough on Nuke. Do you feel like we need more rushes from H2K? More more effort.
I mean, Hoyland so far hasn't had a chance to shoot a bullet at someone. He has 15 health, so now he's going to be dead.
Oh, double kill with
the
grenade.
That's also why you don't stand still in like choke points when you're on a T-side eagle.
Yep, that's actually a very, very common spot for pre-nades as well. So, here we go, 6-3.
The basic principle of how you're supposed to play an eco is you have to mass attack an area and you have to swarm. And so what that means is you have to constantly be moving, because then at least the guy spraying can be missing you, and you're only aiming for headshots to try and put bullets onto him. And because you've got two or three people, ideally you're all going to be shooting at one guy and trying at least get the kill that way, because you're only going for kills. They're trying to just take you out. So you actually have a different objective to what the other guy's doing. He's just trying to kill each of you, whereas you're just trying to get one or two kills, you know. So if you play it properly, it should be possible in an ideal world to get those one or two kills every eco round if you had the right timing, you know.
The problem tends to be those pre-smokes.
Sometimes people do take it as though it was a gun round, though, and they just, I'm aiming at this guy trying to headshot him, you're aiming at that guy, and we go in uncoordinated.
It looks like NIP are going to suss out the movement from H2K here, who are beginning to just charge outside down secret. Freiburg is going to be put to the test. Here goes Rubino.
Already down now. He's going to be in a position any second.
Good entry frag, and Polly gets get right there. So now they are making great ground onto the lower side.
How fast can players rotate though?
But Hoyland has the smoke.
They're already in position to pincer them.
Here we go, Rubino's going to try to jump through. Look at these great grenades coming in from H2K. Should help massively. Just have to execute. Does spray down Forest. And Fifferin's still there, though. But look at this coming in from MacLord. Problems in the back, though, exist. Has the vents under lock and key as Polly is working, kind of flanking with the AWP, but exists still in the vents, lurking. And Fifferin on 3 health. May just be 3 health, but he is a presence to be feared, as Exist does take down Rubino. Odds are getting better, but now it's just NIP Fifflerin alive for the CT side, and there's nothing he can do. Very chaotic round towards the end, but H2K, they managed to execute well outside. I think they had a bit of luck as well, though.
I mean, as we said, this was going to be a more competitive game, so the moment it is headed that way, I still think Nips, they're doing fine at the moment. No need to panic yet. But H2K only needs to get a couple more rounds, and they're at least in position to make this an interesting game as we head later into the game.
And here comes a smoke from Rubino, which is always great to see. Smoke so powerful outside to gain position. Just boosting his teammate up on the crate there. So they just want a little bit of presence from the outside. They don't want to make a concerted effort there together as a team just yet. As you can see, Fiber scanning the upper side to try to listen for information, either from the sounds or from his team. Looks like H2K setting up for a push onto the ramp room. As soon as that smoke dissipates, they're going to run on through. Another smoke from Freiburg there onto Hut. And NIP are starting to realize what's happening. They're starting to rotate already. This rush may be a bit too slow. Let's see what they can do in the ramp. They do manage to take down Fifflerin. Forest gets a trade onto MacLord, though, and he is still a presence. He's still alive. And H2K, at the very least, they did gain some positioning. And Getright's going to be working outside, going to be making his way around for that flank. Here he is going to find Polly from behind. Oh, Polly going to get taken down. Very unfortunate for him now, as Exist goes through the ramp. And here goes Hoyland. Has to try to take this duel, but Exist, much better position to win that one. It's just on two players now from H2K. They have the bomb down. Great headshot onto Getright, but the grenade is going to finish him off. All on Rubino, 1v3, and there's nothing he can do. And here is the defuse coming in from NIP.
That's why when I describe the NIP communication, I always say fluid. Because it's not as though they just tell the other teammates, oh, they're lower, and then the teammates just rush lower as fast as they can. In that scenario there, another team, when they heard the raw ramp, would have had Exist go really quickly out the hut and rush behind them and try and get the kills. Instead, he actually went slowly the same route, while instead Getright was sneaking outside. So they already knew Getright's going to go outside and be along the lower part anyway. So actually, they allowed the right person to engage at the right point in the round. Instead of, they didn't all just collapse in, but fluid in the sense of like the timing is really good for when one person does something and another person doesn't do something.
And H2K are actually taking some aggression outside. They got one AK on Skirk, just going straight in there. Look at that MacLord running into Getright, takes him down with ease. Now, the Forest does take Hoyland down in the attempt. So H2K getting a lot of ground on the outside. They may start being a little bit still, but that's a huge issue now. Skirt going to lose the only rifle. Oh, actually, Markle managed to pick up an M4A4, but still lacking on rifles. Polly does grab the fallen AK, and he does manage to find a frag onto Freiburg. Biffrin goes down too. It's two versus two. Now a two on, still a two on two there, but what are they going to do? What are the options like here for H2K? They've got so much time.
And their problem is Forrest is going to spot them now, and he can play long range. He doesn't even have to engage the other guy if he wants mono.
And Exist is on upper side, so there's a lot of flexibility for Forrest and how he can position himself. And Markle is going to just take it slow. And notice, of course, he has no body armor here, so and no helmet at all, of course. So
yeah, but he's going to have he could potentially have a chance to shoot Forrest in the side of the head now.
Oh, he does spot Forrest. One-on-one, up the ladder he goes. And there's Exist. Can he win the fight? He cannot. Almost very close. Well played, though, from Markle. Almost did it. Some great patience. And
one of the things you noticed, actually, is this in 1.6, there were times on certain teams where you had to have the AWP outside, and so you needed someone to provide coverage. But in CSGO, Forrest's long-range like burst aim is so ridiculous, his first shot, that he essentially covers the whole outside angles just with the rifle. And he actually does it like in the same way as an AWP would have. Like where when you spot him super long range, it's very hard for you to hit him, but he's going to hit you immediately.
And it's like Fifthrin will take down Skirk. So they are pushing fast on the outside, and great movement from H2K out there, getting that map control. Forrest, let's see if he can do exactly what we're talking about. Looks like his angle's a bit too compromised there, so he's going to fall back as Hoyland gains some ground here.
And unfortunately, it looks like they want to hit upper, which would be the wrong attack right now.
Let's really see what Hoyland can do. He's going to have to contend with Fiffler, and if he can win this duel, it's going to be amazing for H2K, opening up ramp as well. He does win the duel against Fiffler, and they have 50 seconds on the clock, so they have a lot of options now, as they have the CT side, the three players remaining, Forrest, Exist, and Freiburg, kind of sandwiched into the upper bomb site. But do they know that? And great pick from Macord, moving into the site. Freiburg gets the trade, but they know where he is now.
Yeah, the time is so much against these players now. So they're rushing lower, but Nip knows this already.
And this is really tough indeed. H2K, they are 3 versus 2 though, and Hoyland might get the drop on both players in defense. This could be huge right here from, oh, but how does that even happen? Hoyland goes down to Freiburg. Hoyland had the game, the round rather, in his hands. And it slipped through his fingers as Exist cleans up Polly. Rubino tries to plant the bomb, but there's nothing he can do. And that felt like such a waste opportunity. Really unfortunate, the timing for Hoyland. He's gotta be really face palming right now.
That's an example of a round where I wish I had the comms for the CTs. Because did they just guess that the right move was to just keep three stacked at the upper and not even have anyone looking outside? Or did they know based on something that they heard, like it's going to be there? Because the way it was, the round was completely open if those H2K players wanted to go lower, and they would have probably got down and got the bomb plant, in fact, because of the positions like off in the rafters. But instead, Nip looked like they were like reading their mind by doing it like that.
Indeed, and it's just two players left now on the pistol round. They didn't really accomplish much in this round, but we're going to be looking at 10-4. So H2K will be entering a position where they can maybe make it 10-5, which is quite acceptable. You know, that's decent. You're happy with that, I think, most of the time on the T side.
And that was an IP for sure.
And that was all off the strength as well of the pistol round that they won at the beginning. So the last round of the first half has begun. We have all AKs for H2K.
I wonder why I even say NIP. I don't think I ever used to say, I used to say NIP, I'm pretty sure. But I think listening to Anders is like, NIP on the gun round here. They've got to make something happen. Okay, that was my, it was bad, but that was my Anders impression. I'm working on it, okay.
Yeah, you got to keep time. It going. It's not as good as your tosspot impression.
No, it's not as good. I'll get it.
Oh, nice challenge there from Rumina though. And yeah, definitely trying to make this competitive. They are going to get themselves down. And this is pretty clean, and they didn't drop a player at all in the kind of journey down towards the lower site. But you can see Forrest and Fiffler, and they're so strong up here. And perhaps that push was on the assumption that at least one of the players from LAP would have rotated from ramp to lower already, but that wasn't just not the case. And now H2K are in a 4-on-4 situation, losing perhaps as much strength that could come from a flank. And Freiburg's in a brilliant position. NIP know exactly what's happening right now, and they're just capitalizing on it massively. Polly does manage to take down Freiburg, but that's it. That's all he can do, and it's 11-4 for the first half. Did this half match your expectations, Thorin? Were you impressed or disappointed with H2K? What are your thoughts for that?
I'm actually a bit disappointed because we've seen another team where the worse things go, the more they slow down. And yet what's going wrong for you is that you're giving NIP too much space. The whole reason why attacking a team who's more skilled than you really quickly is a bad approach in terms of they'll outskill you, okay? But at least I'd rather take the fight on that ground than play into their strength of out-communicating you.
Here we go. We have the pistol round. And wow, Polly just popping off Fiffleren's head. That's a beautiful thing to see. Here comes a bit of a push from Hutt. Forrest, though, he's ready for that. So H2K, they lost a man. NIP lost a man. And H2K falling right back onto the lower bombsite. Hoyland has to hit at least one head, and he does manage to do so. Here comes the knives, and Forrest gets it. It's a lot of money, 1500 in the bag for Forrest. He's going to be happy with that. Some AWP money for him as Rubino tries to take the challenge there. And look at that, Get Right already knows Michael to be there. Here comes Rubino. Can he do it? It is a 3-on-3, but they will get the plant and the knife money. Nasty shot there from Forrest. At the side of the head of Polly, and NIP have this in the bag. 1-on-2, Rubino trying to make it happen. He does the dance with Get Right, moving into a more exposed position, trying his best to stay alive, but Get Right will finish him off, and that's going to be the pistol going to NIP. So well played to the Swedes.
Now will we see, yet again, the NIP gun round? When we get to the fourth one, we're not on it now, obviously. Will they just do that outside attack again? Will it start the same way and then they just peel them out, or will they do something different? That's what I want to see.
Yeah, I agree. I do love the structure from NIP's play. I love how well they deduce the situation from the information they have. They relay the information and they make the call as a team to react. They're so good at that. It's almost scary. We can see Polly here, who's down all the way down in secret. And Fiffler making nice little frag through the smoke. And Freiburg's trying to scout out for Polly, who, you know, is in a position where he needs to get information. And you can see, again, that position is so strong for Freiburg. And Polly feels pressured to try to get information. He peeks out and he dies. So NIP playing this push well. Slow, considered, precise. And Skirt gets dropped as well. Only two players remaining for H2K, as NIP have yet to lose a single man. But CZ75 auto in the hands of Rubino, and Maclord with the 5-7 going to find himself a weapon as he makes the kill in the forest. Not for long, he's running to save that, but yeah, no dice. So Rubino just going to keep... Oh, nice little jump onto the silo there. They may have heard that, actually, if they had someone on upper.
One thing I'll never understand about what even pro teams sometimes do is when you're on a full pistol eco, why on a map like Nuke, you would engage the enemy who has a rifle at the longest possible range, and when you're out in the open, so that if you miss your first shot, then he's just in like a shooting gallery, just tapping away at you. I've never understood why pro players do that.
It's because they feel the force, the magic tingling through their fingers.
That's sort of what they're doing. It's like, in fact, that's one of the things I always think of, right? In the first Star Wars movie, when he's in that situation where he has to fire that, like, missile down that exhaust hatch.
Surely
if that, like, tracking computer actually was really good, then he's like a total dick for turning that off. And if he misses, then everyone's like, what are you doing, you prick? That was like our... Now we're enslaved by the Empire because you turned your fucking tracking shit off over some woo-woo New Age bullshit that you heard from some old dude who probably wouldn't have fucked you. Anyway, back to the game. We've got NIP versus H2K here. I didn't want to get too much into that there. But basically, don't use the force. It's irresponsible. I think computers are better for these things.
I think you got the point across pretty well there. NIP, though, are on next level against H2K. They don't need any Jedi trickery. They're They got this in the bag. H2k trying to do what they can with the pistols. And it's pretty damn tough on Nuke with pistols, to be honest. There's so many long ranges to abuse. And you can see that's exactly what NIP have done. They've used the strength for their weapons. They've moved outside where they have the strength. Like Foreign made the point earlier, why would you take a fight long range with a pistol against a rifle? That's the philosophy here. And here you have, the oldest trick in the book. Two players, one position. Hoyland's not going to peek there if his mate dies. Here you go. Ollie's going to spot one player, relay the information to his team. They're starting to rotate now, but still, just with pistols, it would be surprising if they're able to accomplish much with this. And here comes Exist with a double on the upper bomb site. And look at this Forest, he knows exactly what's happening. Even spots the second player. There is just nothing Hoyland can do. Actually, as I say that, he takes down Forest, but it doesn't even matter. And no Linkin Park references, please. I saw you make a Linkin Park reference with Khan when you were casting. Sure. That's enough for at least a month.
No, no. It'd be too much.
It's like a big cooldown.
I like to keep it classy, you know.
Yeah. And folding the force of score. So H2K on their last attempt here, really, because their money situation is terrible if they lose this. So let's see if they're able to accomplish a good defense against NIP. Really looking to try to read NIP well, but NIP going for this aggression outside, a bit of pressure outside, a bit of pressure from Freiburg on Squeaky. They're all over the place, just pushing this to execution battles, of which you'd love to favor NIP. The ninjas aren't very ninja-like right now, just facing all over the place. And just taking it slow now, waiting for a mistake. And no one's died, but NIP have done a lot of damage to the players of H2K. Fifth room's a little bit weak, but that's all right. So here goes Rubino. He's going to go for the defense. Dropping down. Beautiful play from Rubino for the double. Picks up the AK, swaps it out for his M4. Takes down the bomb carrier, looking for the fourth frag. Exist will take him down, but he has done more than his fair share as Fifth room now with 14 health is just scattering outside.
Completely gone for NIP, so. Yeah, that was the round one pretty much on that one play.
I love that from him. Great stuff from Rubino. Even the only player dying. So big round for them. But still, as we can see on the money, it is not the best situation in the world. It was great that so many of them stayed alive. If they're able to win this one, they're going to be more comfortable economically. But when we talk about economic stuff in this game, it's 14-5. I mean, they can't really afford to lose.
They have to win
rounds.
Everything anyway. So
exactly.
Really,
so I shouldn't really be talking about economy. And here we go. Fifferin making his way outside as he does. Nice bit of spray control, but one of his teammates gets taken down behind him. He's angry. He wants the revenge frag if they are so bold as to re-peak. But in the meantime, NIP control the ramp. So it's 2-on-3 now, and actually H2K are able to trade well for positions. NIP are gaining ground, but the cost is quite heavy. And H2K, you know, having the CT advantage, or rather the number advantage, is really important as a CT side. So here we have Marklord dropping down to lower, where Get Right is in the smoke and Exist. Gonna take him down as he was fixated on the smoke. But Rubino in a fantastic position, full health, full armor. His teammate gonna open the door, one health on Skurk. Oh, look at that. Rubino knows these angles inside and out. Exists the last man. They know where he is. Can they do it? There goes the nade. Skurk goes down. And Rubino gets the trade. Good stuff. So H2K with another round. Bomb has been defused. It is perhaps worth noting, though, that they did lose four players. So it's kind of really sucky for them. All the time having to rebuy everything.
Okay, so what was the rounds that the first team got, MYM versus NIP? Was that like 16-4 or something? I think so. So 16-4, and then we had 16-7. So can H2K get to 8 rounds? That's the new game.
That is a new game.
Let's see. I mean, they've already done some good damage there on that opening gambit, so. We've got a chance on this round.
But NIP is just running outside. This is the first time we've just seen them do a just massive push outside, just running for it. They do lose one man, but they do gain a lot of ground.
And wants to go quickly behind them here.
He cannot win the duel, though. Exist takes him down. That is really important now, because if Polly had been able to hold that angle, that cuts
now,
down the options.
Position here would have been crucial, because they were instantly killed. Because if he could have killed that guy, then he could have totally thrown off the rotation. Whereas now it's almost certain that it's going to be lower. At least you'd hope the guy at ramp's communicating that, because where else can they be at this point?
Exactly. And the grenades should be very telling as well. Exist going to hop into the vent. Might find himself a frag. No, he does not. Rimino turns around in good time. Bomb does go down for NIP, though. And Forest, a bit exposed to Rubino's position. They're going to clean up. Two players left standing. And very good round from H2K there, to be honest. I mean, NIP, they were with a fast rush outside, straight down secret. And it's the first time we've seen it on a buy round, a really, really fast committed push. You know, with the smokes outside, straight down secret. They dropped one man early into that push. And H2K, they reacted well. And now they have the 7 rounds, so maybe they can get the 8. So only get right with a Galil there, trying to, you know, equalizing the money with that Galil. So let's see how they use get right, because as he is the player with the rifle, the player they have chosen to have the rifle as well, carries some responsibility. Skirk there with the M4A1S. Catching quite a few players traversing the yard. Just not able to find the frags. He's getting kind of low. He needs to back away. And it looks like NIP are just doing phenomenal amounts of damage. H2K having a very poor time with the aim battles at the moment. Goes to a 3-on-4. But Fifflerin has the AWP though, so he's going to be slow to move around. 2-on-4. This is such a tricky spot for H2K. They have no map control at all either, and they have no idea exactly where the bomb is. So Rubino is going to be in a very versatile position in the vents. It's kind of a must that he has to be in the vents. And with two players left, that's something that NIP can deduce, that there has to be a player there. Fifflerin working those angles, got his teammates synchronizing with him. Beautiful synchronization between the NIP players to take the upper site, to take the round, and to bring it to match point. So H2K, forced by, we're seeing a couple mags in there. Love the mag. So with the mags, you'd expect either a play around secret or maybe even a push into lobby aggressively with those. It's a much more powerful weapon. Playing aggressively in the close quarters.
I mean, I would hope they'd just do a full wrap on upper. Which at the moment, yeah, I'll have to say.
And Maclaw trying his luck
with
the mag.
It's a bit too easy, really.
Yep, indeed it was. And the shooting gallery continues. Just one man standing. And 16-7. Final score, NIP take it down. H2K with a good few rounds. Decent performance. And what are your thoughts, Thorin, on what we just saw?
I mean, the same story over and over again on teams trying to play T-side against NIP. Almost the same outcome every single time in terms of how it went. I would hope these sorts of teams look at this and either you don't play Nuke against NIP or you take the lesson from this that, like, that approach, after enough rounds, just doesn't work, you know?
Certainly. So we've seen 3 NIP games in a row. We're coming out to our last match of the night for Group A. It's going to be H2K versus Kick. So for anyone who's just here for NIP, we're done with NIP. We just had 3 NIP games. H2K and Kick are coming up right after this break, which we'll take now.